Girolamo Fracastoro, Wikipedia Audio. Girolamo Fracastoro was an Italian physician, poet, and scholar in mathematics, geography and astronomy. Fracastoro subscribed to the philosophy of atomism, and rejected appeals to hidden causes in scientific investigation. Fracastoro was born in Verona, Republic of Venice, and educated at Padua, where at 19 he was appointed professor at the university. On account of his eminence in the practice of medicine, he was elected physician of the Council of Trent. A bronze statue was erected in his honor by the citizens of Padua, while his native city commemorated their great compatriot by a marble statue. He lived and practiced in his hometown. In 1546 he proposed that epidemic diseases are caused by transferable tiny particles or spores that could transmit infection by direct or indirect contact or even without contact over long distances. In his writing, the spores of diseases may refer to chemicals rather than to any living entities. He appears to have first used the Latin word fomes, meaning tinder, in the sense of infectious agent, in his essay on contagion de contagione et contagiosis morbus, published in 1546, I call fomites such things as clothes, linen, etc., which although not themselves corrupt, can nevertheless foster the essential seeds of the contagion and thus cause infection. His theory remained influential for nearly three centuries, before being superseded by a fully developed germ theory. Fracastoro's landmarks in Verona. The name for syphilis is derived from Fracastoro's 1530 epic poem in three books, Syphilis Civ Morbus Gallicis, about a shepherd boy named Syphilis who insulted Greek god Apollo and was punished by that god with a horrible disease. The poem suggests using mercury and guaiacol as a cure. His 1546 book also gave the first description for typhus. The collected works of Fracastoro appeared for the first time in 1555. A portrait of Fracastoro that has been in the collection of the National Gallery since 1924 has recently been attributed to the renowned Italian painter Titian. The reattribution has led scholars to speculate that Titian may have painted the portrait in exchange for syphilis treatment. A marble portrait statue of Girolamo Fracastoro by the Carrarese sculptor Donizzi Cattaneo stands on a beautiful arch in the central Piazza dei Signori of Verona, near the monument to Dante Alighieri. On its base is the inscription, Here Fracastorio /Poli Filippi F /Ex Publica Octoritate /Decata /Insalmdlix. According to a popular legend, the stone ball Fracastoro holds in his right hand, symbolizing the world, will fall on the first honorable person to walk under the arch. Over the centuries, many people have passed every day under the arch, but the ball remains in place. The statue in its context. The statue with the inscription. The lunar crater Fracastorius is named after him. As quoted from Charles Lyell's Principles of Geology, it was not till the earlier part of the 16th century that geological phenomena began to attract the attention of the Christian nations. At that period, a very animated controversy sprung up in Italy, concerning the true nature and origin of marine shells and other organized fossils, found abundantly in the strata of the peninsula. The excavations made in 1517, for repairing the city of Verona, brought to light a multitude of curious petrifactions, and furnished matter for speculation to different authors, and among the rest to Fracastoro, who declared his opinion, that fossil shells had all belonged to living animals, which had formerly lived and multiplied, where their exovii are now found. He exposed the absurdity of having recourse to a certain plastic force, which it was said had power to fashion stones into organic forms, and, with no less cogent arguments, demonstrated the futility of attributing the situation of the shells in question to the Mosaic deluge, a theory obstinately defended by some. That inundation, he observed, was too transient, it consisted principally of fluviatile waters, and if it had transported shells to great distances, must have strewed them over the surface, not buried them at vast depths in the interior of mountains. His clear exposition of the evidence would have terminated the discussion forever, if the passions of mankind had not been enlisted in the dispute, and even though doubts should for a time have remained in some minds, they would speedily have been removed by the fresh information obtained almost immediately afterwards, respecting the structure of fossil remains, and of their living analogues. The clear and philosophical views of Fracas Toro were disregarded, and the talent and argumentative powers of the learned were doomed for three centuries to be wasted in the discussion of these two simple and preliminary questions. First, whether fossil remains had ever belonged to living creatures, and secondly, whether, if this be admitted, all the phenomena could be explained by the Noachian deluge. Fracas Toro's landmarks on the moon. Geology. Works. Notes.